Thank you, man. Thank you so much. Thank you kindly. Appreciate it. Thank you so sweetly. Good morning, men. Good morning. You know, I just met Joaquin and his little boy, Nathan, you know? And Joaquin, lift up your son up in the air just so they can see how old he is, okay? There you go. Hi, Nate. How are you, love? Now, the reason I say that, because, see, there was one time when I was like Nathan. I live without no head trips. You don't see him tatted down, do you? You don't see him bald-headed, do you? You don't see him mad-dogging, do you? All that happens in life. Coming and driving through here, I'm reminded where I'm from. I'm from East LA. I'm from Boyle Heights. And by the grace of God, I served my country, and I went to the Marine Corps, and I got my Calvet home, and I now live in La Mirada. I have been living there for 26 years. My first home was in Baldwin Park, bought through VA again. I wouldn't have bought a house if it wasn't for the veterans. All this to say to you that I was able to move out of the hood into a better myself, and that's what we're all trying to do in life. So our neighborhood, you know, has been safe, with the exception of 2 days ago. There was a massive raid, 3 houses down. And I knew what was going on. And my wife filmed it, you know, Chismolera. She went and she videotaped the takedown. And I'm thinking, wow, it's also affecting us. But as I drove up here, I see the economic deprivation. I saw the projects. You see the streets, they're not taken care of because they don't belong to the people. It belongs to someone else that doesn't live in the community. We see the educational failure. We see what causes us to be who we are, especially in this side, in this community. I see it. In upper circles, it's called the pathology of a social breakdown. That's a fancy word to say that something obviously is going wrong. Many social scientists attribute it to economic deprivation. Others, a lack of education. Others, to the breakdown of family. Others, to civic neglect. Others, to gang domination, gang infiltration. And it seems like there's no control. The politicians don't know what to do. Social scientists don't know what to say. Civic leaders, they don't know what to say. The city fathers, they don't know what to do. And it is what it is and what you see here. I believe with all my heart that that sin has affected the lives of our community. When you go to church, when was the last time that you study Satanology? When was the last time you went to a service and the pastor opened up and said, let's study Satan today? We don't do that. But when you go into the ministry, you study everything about the Bible. We begin what we call bibliology, the study of the Bible. And then specifically, theologically, or theology, the study of God. But primarily, specifically, if you're a Christian, you come to that subject of Christology. What is Christology? The study of everything, of the person, the character, the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you get into the doctrine of Jesus Christ. What did Jesus do? And so eventually you go into other facets. You get into soteriology, which means salvation. You get into evangelism. You get into angelology, the study of angels, spirituality, the study of spirits. And then there's demonology, the study of Satan. Satan, as you know, is featured in the beginning of the book of Genesis. Agree with that? And it's mentioned all the way even to the end of the book Revelation. In the Old Testament, his feature is personified in people, personified in tactics. And Jesus spoke about him. David encountered him. Peter and James says that the only way we can fight him and get him off of us would be to get closer to God. And make sure that we confess our sins. Because one of the weapons of Satan that he does is he has many weapons. If he was to have a sale on weapons of what he uses, He will sell everything at a yard sale, but he will not sell one weapon. He will not. And that will be discouragement. Because discouragement comes our way. Especially where we're at in our community. There's so many factors for us to say, that ain't going to work. I can't do it. You know, I can't. And the reality is that the stupefaction, that means someone keeps you stupid. The stupefaction is that he keeps you ignorant. In the Old Testament, there is a man by the name of Hezekiah. There's another guy by the name of Zedekiah. Okay, so the way I don't have a good memory. But the way I differentiate between these two kings of Israel, one from Judah, one from Israel, is that one starts with a Z, Zedekiah. Jerusalem was taken away from him, and he just basically, he belly flopped and capitulated. With a Z, I call him a zero. Hezekiah starts with an H, and I call him a hero. It is him that I want to bring to your attention. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity. I thank you for Pastor Day giving me this privilege that I have to proclaim and explain your gospel. May you speak to each and every one of us in whatever station of our private world we're in. We ask, Father, to forgive us, to cleanse us. The Lord, that your precious blood would sanctify and hygienize our heads, our minds, our souls, our spirits. We pray, Father, for our families, our home, especially our children, to shelter them, Father, from the madness we went through, and to protect them and bring them up in the ways of the Lord. I am blessed by Joaquin. I am blessed by him bringing his son here to brainwash him already that there is hope in you, that he doesn't have to end up like us. We thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 There's some things that happen in our neighborhood. You don't have to be a Christian. You don't have to be a religious person. But in my community, when we would see things that were evil, they're evil things all the time. But when you see some things that go over the line, we say things like, that's chamuco stuff, man. I mean, you know what I'm referring to, right? That's some fill in the blank. That's not cool, man. That has nothing to do with gangs. That has nothing to do with culture. That has nothing to do with lack of education. That has nothing to do with being stupid. That has nothing to do with tweaking. That has nothing to do with none of that. They went beyond the line, dude. And you realize that there's something wrong here. This is evil. This is maliciousness. The Bible says through Jesus Christ that Satan has come to steal and destroy. And that's what he does. That's the agenda that he does. It's in the Old Testament, we see it. Now, it's not fair for you because, it's in 2 Kings chapter 18 and 19. But it's also featured in 2 Chronicles chapter 32 and then one more in Isaiah, two chapters, 36 and 37. Why in Isaiah? Because King Hezekiah was the king of Israel, of Judah, forgive me, 25 years old. At 25 years old, and then there's a prophet by the name of Isaiah during that time. And they're both interplay, you'll see in a moment. Time does not permit me to share the whole chapters, but let me encapsulate what is taking place. Hezekiah becomes the king of Judah. Now, during that time, the nation of Israel is divided. We have the northern kingdom and we have the southern kingdom. 10 tribes are up north, 2 tribes are down south. They're broken. They're divided. The capital of the north is the capital called Samaria. The capital of the south, meaning Israel, is Jerusalem. So we have 2 kings. So whenever we are introduced, for example, King Hezekiah became a king at the age of 25 when the king of Israel was reigning so many years. So they give you a contrast between both kingdoms. So Hezekiah, according to 2 Kings, he becomes the king of Israel at the age of 25. When you look at his pedigree, when you look at his background, his daddy was all tore up, jacked up, evil. And yet he came out and he was a godly man. We are told that Hezekiah trusted in the Lord of Israel so that after him was not like him among all the kings of Judah, nor who were before him. The features of this man is that not only he was a young man, but he was God-loving. He had a moral constitution. What's a moral constitution? He did what was right in the sight of the Lord according to all that his father King David did. He was a man of courage. He removed the high places of pagan worship. He was also a reformer. Age 25 years old, he was a reformer. He removed all the high places of pagan worship. He was also very faithful. He held fast to the Lord. He did not depart from following him. And he was also very unique because there was none like him afterwards and there was no one like him before. And then the hand of God was upon this man. He was also a man of war. So here's what happened. In a gist, let me capsulize. He becomes king of the south. All of a sudden, there is an empire called the Assyrian Empire. And they're inching down south towards Samaria. And eventually, it takes 3 years to dismantle the whole nation. And they take him captive. Since then, the ten tribes of Israel have been missing to this day. The 10 tribes. The Bible tells us in the future that the 10 tribes of Israel and Judah will come together in the end times. But still, no one knows if you're one of the 10 tribes. The 10 tribes are gone. They decimated the northern kingdom. Samaria was occupied by the king of Assyria. And here comes now the 25-year-old. He's very scared. We are told that the Lord was with Hezekiah. And that he prospered wherever he went, and he rebelled against the king of Assyria, and he did not serve him. That he subdued the Philistines, this is the enemy of Israel, as far as Gaza and his territory, from the watchtower to every fortified city. It came to pass in the fourth year of King Hezekiah, which was the seventh year of Hoshea, the son of Elah, the king of Israel, that Shalmaneser, king of Assyria, came up against Samaria and besieged it. He's now 29 years old. Think of the pressure of a 25-year-old kid. I say a kid, if you're 25, no offense. When I got out of the military, I was 21 years old. I thought I was a man. And I was a man, but I was 21 years old, mocoso. Little pendejito. And I thought I knew everything, and I did. I did. I got out as a corporal, and I did, but I was very young. And I look back and I'm thinking, wow, what happened to me this time? King Hezekiah was a good man. From the get-go, he was a good man. God had blessed him. Unlike most of us, I don't know when it has started in your life. Something happened in our lives. You weren't that angry. You didn't have this disposition. You don't have this attitude. You didn't have this mad dogging. You didn't have this kind of response. You were outgoing. You were playing marbles or you were playing tag. You didn't like girls. You only liked hanging around with boys. There was a time where you were innocent. Mentally, emotionally, you were innocent. Somewhere along the line, something happened to you. For me, it was 11 years old. 11 years old. She was 19. She tricked me. She played me. And she took away, she robbed me of my innocence. Because what she did, she tweaked me for life. Because you see, what she did was perverse. And I was young. I didn't know how to digest it. I didn't know how to computer. I didn't know how to, what do you call that? It'll come to me, man. I used to sniff glue, forgive me. Process it. I didn't know how to process this. All I know is that after I became a Christian, when I read the Songs of Solomon, Songs of Solomon says, do not awaken love when you're too young. Why is that? Because you don't understand what is taking place in the chemistry of your body emotions. I'm 11 years old. And she's 19. She's an experienced chola. She knows what she's doing. She is manipulating me. she is causing me to do things that I don't like, yet I like and I enjoy, and now I'm her little robot. Don't tell anyone about this. It's between you and I. There, the blemish of my conscience, the first spot. I, like a little deer in heat, I go back, hoping that I get those crumbs of lust. And I sure did once again. And I was back into that situation. Then I realized that I wasn't the only one. I thought I was the only one. So I left already with a tweaked mind and a tweaked conscience. What I would call a blemished conscience. There was a secret already. I couldn't tell my mother. I couldn't tell anyone. Because I didn't want anybody to enjoy what I was enjoying. In my own perverseness. As I got older, I had a girlfriend, and I wanted that girlfriend to behave as trampa, as scrapa. But she was not doing what the scrapa was doing. I left that. I went to another little relationship, you know, trying to get it. And I wanted what the scrapa did to me, and there was nothing. Because the scrapa was abnormal. I believe she was an agent of chamuco. Because she distorted my view of sex, relationship, the objectivity of women. I looked at them different. So as I got older, as I went overseas, think about it. I'm 18 years old. They ship me across the other side of the world. And I go to Singapore. I go to the Philippines. There I find more perversion. Anybody served in the military? Anybody went to the Philippines? And more perversion. And that only enhanced my perversion. And then all of a sudden, things that happen and things that you're doing, by that time, you are tweaked. Now, Hezekiah, on the other hand, was spared. Because the Bible says the hand of the Lord was upon him. But even too, he made a mistake. What mistake did he do? He says that at the end of the 3 years, the Assyrians took Samaria in the north. And in the sixth year of Hezekiah, now he's 31. In the ninth year of Hoshea, the king of Israel, Samaria was taken. Then the king of Assyria carried Israel away captive to Assyria and put them in Hala and by the Habor, the river of Gozan, in the cities of the Medes. So the king of Assyrian took the 10 tribes, captivated, and pulled them out of their land. Why? For 3,000 years, the land of Israel has become a very desirable real estate. For 3,000 years, let me ask you, is there conflict right now in the land of Israel? Big time. Around 200, 300 rockets have gone off from Gaza. And likewise, the IDF, the Israeli Defense Forces, already went back and bombed strategic places. So there's conflict going on all the time for that piece of real estate. That's what they were taking it. So the Assyrians took it. It says, then the king of Assyria, he says, they were taken, the children of Israel pulled out. And there in 2 Kings chapter 18, verse 12 says, this is the reason why. Because they did not obey the voice of the Lord their God, but transgressed his covenant and all that Moses, the servant of the Lord, had commanded. And they would neither hear nor do them. So this is a swift response. God had told them, you better change your ways. Amend your ways. If not, the judgment is coming. When you look at the book of Isaiah, there in Isaiah in chapter 10, verse 5, God says it very plain when you read it. You can make a note of it. God said, Assyria is in my hand. In other words, Assyria is an instrument of mine, says the Lord, an instrument to judge you for your disobedience. This was not surprising. Prophets had foretold that the enemy will come. If they're disobedient, they were blatant disobedient. Exploitation of the people. Everybody was in cahoots. The priests, the scribes, the royal people, the civic leaders, the politicians. Everybody's mother was included in this exploitation of the people of God. And God said, enough, man, enough. They didn't stop. So the Bible says the Assyrian came as a weapon. As an instrument of judgment against the northern kingdom. And they were pulled out. In the 14th year of King Hezekiah, now he's 39. In the 14th year of King Hezekiah, Sennacherib, he took over, the king of Assyria, came up against all the fortified cities of Judah and took them. Then Hezekiah, king of Judah, sent to the king of Assyria at the city of Lachish, saying, I have done wrong. Turn away from me. Whatever you impose on me, I will pay. And the king of Assyria assessed Hezekiah, the king of Judah, 300 talents of silver and 30 talents of gold. So Hezekiah initially, he flexed out. I ain't going to obey. Come and get it. And King Hezekiah, the Assyrians came and they go, okay, we're here. And he just kind of blank. He says, I made a mistake. So the king of Assyria says, I demand some coin. He shook him down. It was a shakedown. I want this much money, almost around $75 million. Where are you going to get that? You know what Hezekiah did? He doesn't have the money, so he goes to the temple of the Lord. What does he do in the temple of the Lord? He takes all the gold, all the silver, all the precious utensils of gold. He's desecrating that temple. We call that capitulating, or in the hood, we call it ranking out. He ranked out. He just said, I don't want to fight. 39 years old. I still think as a young man, 39 years old. If you're 39, 40, you think you're old. You're young, dude. You're very young. Wait until you hit your 60 and 65. Wait. You're gonna go through a threshold, man. You don't see it. We don't even know where it's at. But you're gonna cross it, and you go, "Dang, I'm getting old." You'll know it. I already went through it. My mom used to tell me about that. Mijo, cálmate. When you'll see, mijo. Sorry. Double P. Then I realized, oh, Mom, I wish you were alive so I can tell you I understand your pain. I don't have that luxury. But you're 40 years old. He's making some quality decisions. So Hezekiah gave him all the silver that was found in the house of the Lord and in the treasures of the king's house. At that time, Hezekiah stripped the gold from the doors of the temple of the Lord and from the pillars which Hezekiah, king of Judah, had overlaid and gave it to the king of Assyria. That was a political move here. Keep us in peace. We don't want to fight. But then we are told that the king of Assyria lied to him. He still wants to destroy them, but he wants to maintain all the structures. He doesn't want to lose none of his men. So the Assyrians had a tactic. They would send messengers, very awesome messengers. They were dressed in a very opulent wear. Their beard was different. It was taken care of. Beard that had braids on it. And they were dressed in colorful, outlandish robes. And they had their whole posse. They had a procession of maybe around 2,000 horsemen, all powerful. And the Bible says that Sennacherib sent three of them, but one of them is Rabshakeh. That's his name. Rabshakeh. His name is not Rabshakeh. That's not a proper name. Rabshakeh will be someone like a secretary of state. And Rabshakeh has given orders by the king to go up to Jerusalem. And of course, when he comes to Jerusalem, the whole city is moved. The Assyrians are coming. Now, you got to know about the Assyrians. The Assyrians were monsters. They were subhumans. Crucifixion started by them. The way they used to crucify people, it's called impalement. Ever heard that word, impalement? It's when they put a stick over you. Someone falls from a second floor and they hit a fence. And the fence went through them. So, oh man, the guy fell. He was impaled. That's what it means. The Assyrians were so cold and calculated that they invented crucifixion. And the goal of crucifixion is for you to die ever so slowly. One of the impalement modes was to capture an enemy, and it was used, the process and the killing or the crucifixion was also a psychological terror tactic to scare the living hell out of the people. It's called shock, like ISIS. Like ISIS shocked the people into submission. The Assyrians will go into a town and they will look for a pregnant lady, hopefully like around 7 months pregnant. And in front of everyone, they will open the belly and they will take the fetus out and they will rip the fetus out. And they grab him by the feet and they will smash him and dash it against the rocks to horrify the people into submission. Those that fought against them when they were captured, to teach him a lesson, they will strip him naked, part of the humiliation. And then they'll have a stick. It was a stick, very sharp, and it was put a stake in the ground. Maybe around 4 feet to 5 feet in length. And it was sharp. Men will grab, 4 or 5 men will grab the victim. By this time, the victim is fighting. The victim knows what's going to happen. And usually, the victim was just going to shock. And it was, thank God, because what they would do, and they will try to ram that stick, right, ram it straight into the rectum. And hopefully, that it comes out through the mouth. You see, people will not die because when you have an open wound, you have a suction wound. And when you have that impalement in there, what's killing you is also helping you survive. Because you're not bleeding. If they take it out, you bleed to death and you die immediately. But as long as you have the stake in there, the pressure in your body, it just stays there. And homeboy stays like he stays like this. And just stays there for a day, day and a half. Nothing but suffering. The Romans, they're the ones that mechanized it. And they made it even harder for people to suffer a long time. So these men were barbarians. These men were monsters. So when they came in, they came into the wall. And the Bible says that Israel, Jerusalem, they were in the wall. And what Rabshakeh says to them is that it's a satanic attack. Satan is personified in Rabshakeh. He goes up to the wall. We read it in a moment. But he goes up in the wall. He goes, my master, the king, Sennacherib, has sent me. He says, if you're trusting in your God, the God of Hezekiah, he's lying to you. He was just fronting them, mimicking them, causing fear, propaganda, psychological terror. And there were 3 men. They were leaders, Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense, and they were speaking for King Hezekiah. When they looked over the fence and they were talking to this man, Rabshakeh, they pleaded with him. He goes, we speak Aramaic. You don't have to speak Aramaic. You don't have to speak Hebrew. And Rabshakeh said, what? I speak Hebrew. So all those in the wall will know that if they don't listen to what we're saying, you're going to eat your own excrement and you're going to drink your own piss. That's what it says. Like that. The terror that he was using. Notice. I read it for you. He says, then the king of Assyria sent Tartan, the Rabsari, and the Rabshakeh from Lachish with the great army against Jerusalem to King Hezekiah. And they went up and came to Jerusalem. When they had come up, they went and stood by the aqueduct of the upper pool, which was on the highway of the fool's field. And when they had called to the king, Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, who was over the household of Israel, Shabna the scribe, the recorder, and Joah the son of Shebna, the scribe, and the son of Asaph, the recorder, came out to them. So we have one who's over the household, one is a scribe, and one is a recorder. They're the spokesmen for Jerusalem and for the king. Then the Rabshakeh said to them, say now to King Hezekiah, thus says the great king, the king of Assyria. Here we go. What confidence is this that you are trusting? You speak of having plans and power for war, but they are mere words. And in whom do you trust that you rebel against me? Now look. You are trusting in the staff of this broken reed called Egypt, on which if a man leans, it will break his hand and pierce through it. So is Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, to all who trust in him. What is he saying? See, Hezekiah was saying, if there's a problem, I got my friends. They're going to back me up. Who's your friends? I got Egypt to back me up. And Rabshakeh said, Egypt? Egypt? It's a broken reed, man. You stand on it, it's going to go through your hand. That's stupid. And he keeps going. Oh, but if you say to me, oh, we trust in our God, Jehovah God, is it not those places that Hezekiah has taken away and said to Judah and Jerusalem, you should worship before this altar in Jerusalem? Now, therefore, I urge you, give a pledge to my master, the king of Assyria, and I will give you 2,000 horses. And sarcastically says, if you are able on your part to put riders on them. See, Israel was not known for rider for horsemanship. The Assyrians were. The Assyrians were master horsemen. The Israelis did not know how to ride horses. So he says, let's make a deal. I'll give you 1,000 horses if you're able to ride them. Sarcasm. How then will you repel one captain of the least of my master's servants and put your trust in Egypt for chariots and horsemen? Have I not come without the Lord against this place to destroy it? The Lord said to me, go up against this land and destroy it. God does not speak to heathen. This is a lie. This is a tactic from Satan. When in the Garden of Eden, the serpent says, has God really said? What's that? Has God really said that you will die? You know, if you eat of this, you will live and you'll be like God. That's not what God said. So Satan, he deceives. He distorts. He twists the word of God. So here Rabshakeh says, your God told me to take this place. Mm-mm. He says, then Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, Shebna, and Joah said to Rabshakeh, please speak to your servants in Aramaic, for we understand it, and do not speak us in Hebrew in the hearing of people who are on the wall. But Rabshakeh said to them, has my master sent me to your master and not to speak to these words and to these men who sit on the wall, who will eat and drink their own waste with you? Then the Rabshakeh stood and called out with a loud voice in Hebrew and spoke, saying, hear the word of the great king, the king of Assyria. He's speaking Hebrew now. Thus says the king, do not let Hezekiah deceive you, for he shall not be able to deliver you from this hand. Nor let Hezekiah make you trust in the Lord, saying, the Lord will surely deliver us. This city shall not be given into the hand of the king of Assyria. Listen, don't listen to Hezekiah. For thus says the king of Assyria, make peace with me by a present and come out to me. And every one of you eat from his own vine and every one from his own fig tree. And every one of you drink the waters of his own cistern. Until I come and take you away to a land, your own land, a land of grain and new wine, a land of bread and vineyards, a land of olive groves and honey, that you may live and not die. But do not listen to Hezekiah, lest he persuade you, saying, the Lord will deliver us. That is another tactic of Satan. I just want to take you from this place and put you in a place where you can live. You know, it was a saying, you got your own fig tree, you got your own house, you got your own vineyard, and you'll be happy. Well, we're already doing that. Why would you want to take us out of here? And that's another lie. Do not listen to Hezekiah. Do not listen to him. He says, has any of the gods of the nations at all delivered its land from the hand of the king of Assyria? He says, where are the gods of Hamath and Arpad? Where are the gods of Sepharvaim and Hena and Iva? Indeed, have they delivered Samaria from my hand? So Rabshakeh says, your God? He says, look what we did to Compton. Where's their God? Look what we did to Lingwood. Where's their God? Look what we did to Watts. Where's their God? And you come and tell me your God's going to take care of you? Look at our record. Your God will not do anything. That's taunting God. But Rabshakeh goes one step further. He goes over the line. He says, your God is not a real God. Now he's stepping in the name that's above every name. God will not be mocked. He goes over the line. He says, who among you, all the gods of the land, have delivered their countries from my hand, that the Lord should deliver Jerusalem from my hand? But the people held their peace and answered him not a word, for the king's commandment was this, do not answer him. So Eliakim, Hilkiah, and Shebna, the scribe, and Joah, the recorder, came to Hezekiah with their clothes torn and told him the words of Rabshakeh. There was the ripping their clothes was an open gesture of grief and anxiety. And they went to the king. And so it was when King Hezekiah heard it, that he tore his own clothes, covered himself with sackcloth, and listened. And he went to the house of the Lord. He went to the house of the Lord and presented his case. And I close with this. Because, see, you have Rabshakehs in your life. I don't know what they are. It could be you're addicted to something that you shouldn't be. And that addiction taunts you. Perhaps you have a past like me that is very psychologically blemishing. I'm healed from that. I'm healed from that by the grace of God. God will not only heal me my past, but he allowed me to not be dictated by that. Because our past can become a bully. Our past can disrupt us and destroy us. We can be the perpetrator or we can be the victim. Both are affected for a lifetime. We guide our life based upon what we think we know, our experiences. We respond, we react, we live in a way that you were brought up by your parents, by your education or lack of, by what you did in experiences. Your body sometimes an expression of your life, how you look at people. Everything in this neighborhood said, well, you know what? This is the way. This is the jungle. This is the way we got to behave. You don't have to. Because when Christ changes you, even a smile can change the whole community. Even a smile. They think you're weird or you're on medication. But it's okay. Especially in this community. Hezekiah brought the note to the Lord and he prayed and he said this. Hezekiah says, O Lord, God of Israel, the one who dwells between the cherubim, you are God, you alone. Of all the kingdoms of the earth, you have made heaven and earth. Incline your ear, O Lord, and hear me. Open your eyes, O Lord, and see and hear the words of Sennacherib, which he has sent to reproach the living God. Truly, Lord, the kings of Assyria have laid waste the nations and their lands. It's true. And have cast their gods into the fire, for they were not gods, but the work of men's hands, wood and stone. Therefore, they destroyed them. Now, therefore, Lord, our God, I pray, save us from his hand, that all the kingdom of the earth may know that you are the Lord and God alone. And then all of a sudden, he sent the letter to Isaiah the prophet. Isaiah reads the letter, and Isaiah tells the king, don't worry about it. Not one arrow will be thrown. Not one lance. Nothing. Watch and see what the Lord would do. That was the message. The next day, 185,000 Assyrian soldiers lay dead outside the gates of Jerusalem. The Bible says that only one angel came. One angel came in the nighttime. 185,000. Sennacherib left with his tail between his legs, went home. He was so defeated, so deflated, that he went to the temple of his God. And in the temple of his God, his own son murdered him and slaughtered him in the temple. And that was the end of Sennacherib. Israel, Judah, Jerusalem was once again spared by the grace of God. What we see here is that there was no power with the horses. There was no power in the material and the material human cleverness. But God alone preserved them. You and I, we live in a world where we're going to go through much tribulation as Christians. If you're not a Christian, you are basically spiritually, you have no defense mechanism. You don't have a helmet. You don't have the breastplate of righteousness. You're not girded with truth. You are not ready. You don't even have a sword. You are open piece of meat out there for the enemy to come and belittle you, destroy you, confuse you, and destroy your family, destroy your life. Like we see a lot, it's called chamuco stuff. I didn't know I was in darkness until I received the Lord, and I was translated from darkness to light, from ignorance to the truth, from being condemned to being enlightened and being forgiven. Didn't know where I was going to, I know where I'm going. And along the way, my children have benefited, my wife has benefited, my community has benefited. I am no longer a menace to the community. I am now a vital member of our community where people invite me to the community to speak to them about the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. Politicians don't have the answers. The government doesn't have the answers. Only God has the answer to transform you and forgive you of your past. Amen? Amen. Listen, I don't know. For being a Saturday morning, a lot of non-Christians don't come. They still crash. So I always assume that a men's breakfast, everybody is a believer. And I can't assume that. Maybe there's one of you here who goes, I just come because it's cool, it's safe, and it's right on. But I'm not a believer. But you could be. It takes only 11 seconds. It's 11 seconds, yeah, but see, you can't do it unless God has spoken to you. Jesus stated so perfectly. He says, no one can come to me. This is what Jesus said. No one can come to me unless my Father in heaven touches that man's heart. So it's not the preacher. It's not how he speaks or how he delivers. It's what God is doing as you heard the word of God. You see, the word of God, when it goes forth, I am told in scripture that the word of God is living, powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword, able to penetrate bone and marrow, and it goes directly into the very seat of our understanding, and that is the heart. And when the word of God goes, it hits, it convicts. And when it convicts, you say something like, man, I'm busted, can't be trusted. I want Jesus. You just can't fake it. Well, you know, I got pre-breakfast. I might as well, you know. No. Today could be that opportunity. And I don't want to make a big fanfare out of it. I'm going to ask you, if you have never received the Lord Jesus Christ, perhaps you received the Lord in the past, but you're out there in the world jacked up, tore up, looking up. You don't have to. You don't have to live like a third-class citizen when you're a child of God. You don't have to do that. So if you would like to receive the Lord, and you would like me to pray with you, or if you want to return to the Lord, you want me to pray with you right now as I close, all you have to say, Pancho, I'm one of them. Would you pray with me? And that's it. If there's nobody, as the Hawaiians say, orale, no problem. But I ask you, does anybody here want to receive the Lord, return to the Lord? Just raise your hand. I'll pray with you, whoever you are, anyone. Are we cool? God bless you, Mico. God bless you. God bless you. Anybody else? God bless you, sir. Wonderful. Here we go. Let me pray with you, okay? And you go along with my prayer. God sees your heart. We don't have to be religious. All that. We don't have to do that. I don't speak to my mom like that. I spoke to my mom. Mom, can I have this? Mom, sure, mijo. She was my mother. It's your heavenly Father. He's about to hear your heart. Would you repeat this simple prayer after me in your heart? Dear Jesus, I love you. I need you. I want you in my heart. I want to have a constitution that belongs to you, just like Hezekiah. Help me in every area of my life. Holy Spirit, fall fresh upon me. Transform me. Wash me, purge me, make me to do those things that are pleasing to you. Thank you for your love and your goodness. Be with us, Father, as we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I think they're going to do a little worship song. And they'll do a worship song. But listen, If you're going through what I will call a Rav Shaka episode, like there's tensions, what Rav Shaka did, he stupefied people with lies. He belittled people by threatening them because they were bigger. We call those things in life the mountains or obstacles in life. And they can become bullies in your life. You can step out of these doors at the end of the service and still carry this huge burden. Like, for example, if I carry, may I? Real quick, like, if I carry this, see? If I carry this right here like this. Pancho, what is that? Oh, what? What you're carrying? What is that? Why are you doing that? Well, Rav Shaka, you know what it is? You know it is, man. How long are you going to be doing this? They leave Rav Shaka. Take it out. I don't need it, Lord Jesus. In the name of Jesus, set me free. Today, in this song, as we worship the Lord, that's just between you and the Lord. Father, thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for this church. Thank you for David and the men that are here. Thank you that there's a light in the community. Thank you for your intervention. May we never forget who we are in you and you in us. Let us know who we is and who we ain't. We are children of God. We are no longer slaves of sin. In Jesus' name, amen.
Now, real quick, we usually we end off with praying for one another. So if you could turn to your neighbor, to your left, to your right, link up with somebody and lift them up in prayer real quick, and then we'll end with one last song, and then we're good.
My soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior. How great thou art.